There's an animation that I've seen a few times showing some shapes being cut up in special patterns which can be rearranged into a different shape. There are transitions to or from squares, equilateral triangles, and regular hexagons. In this video, I want to focus on the equilateral triangle to square transition because it's the simplest, with only three cuts and four pieces. This type of rearrangement is called a dissection, and the dissection here was first described by Henry Dudeney. It's fantastic, mesmerizing even. At its longest extension, it reminds me of the Hawaiian Islands. The animation has a fascinating visual effect, and to replicate it, there were a number of things that needed to be done. First, the pieces rotate steadily and simultaneously from their starting to their ending orientations. Then the pieces are daisy-chained using pivot points to connect them. Finally, the center of mass is held steady, so there is no drift from the center. Unfortunately, it's not necessarily the best animation for instructional purposes, so let's look at a different animation where the pieces move one by one, and then I'll give some problems where we can study the geometry of this. So in this animation, you can more clearly see the unfolding of the top pieces down to line up with the bottom pieces, and then swing around underneath to complete the triangle. It's easier to trace where the pieces in line start and finish, and it allows us to draw conclusions about where some of the intersections must be and how long certain segments must be in relation to each other. So I'll put up a few problems based on this transition, and I think they're a really good exercise for someone studying geometry or trigonometry who wants to use the principles learned in these courses to analyze the structure of this dissection. I'm going to focus on the square for these problems because it's a bit easier to work with. It lines up with the grid on the coordinate plane when you place it at the origin. The first problem is to start with a square and give you Euclidean straight edge and compass construction for this diagram. The straight edge and compass construction is really the bread and butter of Euclidean geometry, and this dissection is a nice exercise for some basic construction techniques. Secondly, we would like to place the square on the coordinate plane centered at the origin with the vertices at plus or minus 1, plus or minus 1, and give xy coordinates of all the endpoints in the figure. And we'll want exact answers in terms of expressions involving rational numbers and their roots, from which we can compute the decimal approximations. Notice that this is not the unit square. It's a square with side of length 2. I'm doing it this way because I think it's good to have symmetry about the origin and to have the vertices of the square on the coordinate grid. Finally, for younger students, or students of all ages really, plot the figure on graph paper, color and cut out, and try to arrange the pieces to form a triangle and then back to form a square again. It's a little puzzle that's not that easy. So let's get down to business, and I'm going to start on these problems with some observations first, and these observations are from watching the second animation. So observation number one. Since the top pieces pivot down and align with the bottom, the pivot points along the left and the right sides of the square are at the midpoints. So that's an easy way to start off the answers to any of these questions with two points whose coordinates are easy to determine and describe. Secondly, let's look at that very busy point inside the square. We'll call this point X, and notice that the three vertices of the dissected equilateral triangle meet at point X. Since each angle is 60 degrees, the angles sum to 180, a straight angle. Another observation is that the boundary between the blue and the green pieces unfolds to form a side of the dissected equilateral triangle. Its length is therefore half the length of an equilateral triangle with the same area of the square. The same holds true for the red-green boundary. The length of those segments are the same. Let's calculate the length of it. If the square has vertices at plus or minus 1, plus or minus 1, its area will be 4. If we solve for the side of an equilateral triangle with area 4, we can find the length of the boundary between blue and green, or green and red. The area of an equilateral triangle in terms of its side is s squared times root 3 over 4. That formula follows directly from using 1 half base times height, where the base is s, and the height is s times root 3 over 2, which you can get in any number of ways, sine of 60 degrees, or better yet, the Pythagorean theorem on a right triangle whose legs are s and s over 2. Setting s squared root 3 over 4 to the area of our square of side 2, which is 4, we do some algebra and find that the side s is equal to 4 over the 4th root of 3. But we really need is half that, since we're looking for the length of a segment that unfolds to that length. So divide by 2 and get 2 over the 4th root of 3. Now let's form a strategy for the construction based on these observations. First, the segments joining point X to the midpoints of the left and right sides of the square form an angle of 60 degrees plus 60 degrees, and that's 120 degrees. By the inscribed angle theorem, the locus of all such points lies along the arc of a circle passing through those midpoints and subtending 2 times 120 degrees, or 240 degrees of arc. We can easily construct this as an equilateral triangle inscribed in a circle. Now let's combine this with the fact that the segment dividing the blue and green has length 2 over the 4th root of 3. We can construct this by taking the square root of 4 over root 3. That's an easy length to construct, and we get it for free because the diameter of the circle in the previous step has exactly that length. So here we go with the construction. I'll do the current step in green each time to highlight it. Construct the midpoints A and B for the left and right sides respectively. Getting the midpoint is an easy basic construction, so I'll omit the details. Next, construct an equilateral triangle with AB as a base and pointing downwards. That's an easy construction as well. Just set the compass on AB and make little arcs with centers A and then B that intersect at the vertex C. Next, circumscribe a circle around this equilateral triangle. You can find the center by intersecting angle bisectors. It's elementary, so I won't show you those details. We've done this because the point X will lie on the arc AB in the upper rectangle. You can take any point on that arc, as long as it's strictly between A and B. Draw segments directly to A and B and the angle will be 120 degrees no matter where on that arc you choose. Moreover, if you draw the line to C, you'll bisect this angle and get two 60 degree angles, and we'll do exactly that later on in the last step since we need that segment. Next, let's extend the diameter AE. As mentioned, AE will have length 4 over root 3, and if we can take the square root of this, we'll have the length between A and X, which is the final piece of information we need to construct X. For the square root construction, we need to add a segment of length 1 to the segment AE, and that will be done by transferring its length to an extension of the left side as shown at AF. Then the next step in the square root construction will involve bisecting the segment GF at H. Then, with HG as a radius, draw an arc to intersect AB at I. This completes the square root construction, and AI is equal to the length between A and X, which is 2 over the 4th root of 3. To find X, then, we just need to take AI as a radius and draw an arc to intersect the arc AB at X. This has to be our point, since it's the only point with the required distance to point A, and it lies on the arc, which will guarantee that angle AXB is 120 degrees. To complete the construction with all required segments, simply extend BX to the top of the square at J, and for the bottom segment, construct segment XC, which by the inscribed angle theorem will bisect the 120 degree angle AXB into a pair of 60 degree angles as required. I'll just remark at this point that this is not the only possible construction, of course, and it may not even be the best construction depending on your criteria. This construction was actually my second attempt. My first attempt was to construct the segment CKX by constructing the small angle XCD that it makes with the vertical. You can actually find a quadratic expression for the tangent of that angle, solve the quadratic, and construct the angle. This took quite a few more steps, so I found a cleaner construction in the one presented. Now in the final slide, we'll get rid of the unused construction lines and show the required segments upon which to dissect the square. And those are the required endpoints and segments. The next problem involves finding the Cartesian coordinates of the points A, B, J, K, and X if we place the vertices of the square at plus or minus 1, as shown. As we remarked earlier, A and B are easy. They are the midpoints of the respective sides and lie along the x-axis at negative 1, 0 and positive 1, 0. X is going to be a little harder. So the approach I would like to use to find X is to bring back the circle from the Euclidean construction, because the center of that circle makes a nice isosceles triangle with A and X along the circumference. It's also tilted 30 degrees from the horizontal because of the equilateral triangle that was constructed first. So by polar coordinates and adjusting for the offset of the center of the circle from the origin, we get a formula for the coordinates of point X. Now we can use some trigonometry to simplify the sine and cosine of those angles. We can find theta because we have all three sides of the triangle. Two of those sides are radii of the circle and the other is a segment AX. The law of cosines is basically an extension of the Pythagorean theorem. We have a squared plus b squared equals c squared, and then a correction of minus 2ab cosine theta when the angle's not a right angle. So after a little algebra, we find cosine theta is 1 minus the square root of 3 over 2. Then sine theta follows from cosine theta by using sine squared plus cosine squared equals 1. The Pythagorean theorem is at the heart of that equality as well. And we take the positive square root for sine theta since the angle is acute. And now we have a more complex expression involving two square roots. Since these angles are offset by 30 degrees, we can use the sum of angles formula to find sine and cosine of theta plus 30. Sine first. Sine of a plus b is sine a cosine b plus cosine a sine b. So substituting what we just found along with sine 30 equals a half and cosine 30 equals root 3 over 2, we get an equation that resists further simplification. So let's move to the next step and multiply by r, which is 2 over root 3. And that's fortunately going to cancel out some of the root 3 over 2 factors. Now to do the same with cosine a plus b, it's cosine a cosine b minus sine a sine b. So again, we get an equation that resists further simplification. And again, we can multiply by r, which is 2 over root 3, and get some cancellations. So let's collect these results and express as coordinates for x. We need to subtract root 3 over 3 to account for the offset of the circle from the origin, and this fortunately cancels an equivalent term. So we have the expression as shown, and by converting to an approximate decimal, we see that this is about where we would expect it, near the center of the first quadrant, so the sanity check passes. Now we're left with j and k. Since b, x, and j lie on a line, we can use the point-slope formula to find j. Let's first calculate the slope between b and x. That's just delta y over delta x, and we get a monster fraction as shown. Let's just use m to represent that for now and substitute y equals 1 because j lies along the top of the square. We'll find x equals 1 plus 1 over m, and let's bring m over and simplify. We've gotten rid of the fractions in the numerator and denominator by multiplying each by 2, and then we've taken the reciprocal. In the next step, I put a negative sign in front and negated the numerator to make it more obvious that the slope is negative. Now we have an expression for the point at j. Now we can take a shortcut for k. It's actually a reflection of j through the origin. When the pieces are rearranged, the segments extending left from j and k are joined end to end, and the pieces extending right from j and k are also joined end to end, and these resulting segments are superimposed, so they must have the same length. This requires that j be a reflection of k through the origin, so k follows from j simply by negating both coordinates. Now let's go to that final puzzle for elementary school students. We would like them to plot the points on a piece of graph paper, join them with the required line segments, then color and cut out pieces that can be arranged into either a square or an equilateral triangle. Now that we know the coordinates of the points, we can look for a whole number scaling factor that produces points reasonably close to grid points on the graph paper. A scale of 14 works well, as you can see in the chart here. J and K are quite close. X needs just a bit more rounding, but nothing too extreme. Now here's what it looked like when I cut it out and colored it, and upon rearrangement I was surprised to see that the grid lines align for each piece. This is because we snapped the pivot points to the grid, and the pivot point at K is not actually on the grid, so the lines should be offset a bit. We've got a little bit of imperfection with the overhang on the left, as you can see, but nothing too extreme. We should ask some questions to help the students learn. For instance, did you use any clues to help you put the puzzle together? Do you expect the triangle and the square to have the same area? Why or why not? And do you expect the triangle and the square to have the same perimeter? Why or why not? So once again, thanks for watching. I hope you learned something from analyzing this interesting transformation. I know I did.